Identifying tumor-specific molecular aberrations via molecular profiling is vital for the use of targeted therapies. Understanding a patient's unique tumor genetics provides predictive and prognostic information that enables a personalized care plan to be put in place, improving outcomes and minimizing ineffective treatments. But what test should you choose? If you want the most comprehensive panel available, what does that really mean? Let's dive into the world of molecular profiling together. Molecular profiling in oncology commonly refers to the testing of tissue samples or biofluids, such as serum, plasma, or urine, with the aim of identifying tumor-specific molecular alterations. Technologies commonly used in molecular profiling include karyotyping, immunohistochemistry, also known as IHC, or immunocytochemistry, also known as ICC, fluorescence in situ hybridization, also known as FISH, PCR-based assays, Sanger sequencing, and next-generation sequencing, also known as NGS. Karyotyping is the staining and pairing of chromosomes to determine abnormalities, and was among the first technologies used for molecular profiling. In conventional karyotyping, Guillaume sustain is used to highlight areas of adenine-thymine bonding in condensed chromosomes. This creates distinctive banding patterns by which the chromosome and the abnormalities within the chromosome can be identified. The resolution of karyotyping is a measure of the number of bands that are visible and is limited to 5 to 10 megabases. This is very low. It is not able to detect small rearrangements or single nucleotide polymorphism. Karyotyping has therefore mostly been supplanted by newer technologies and is now rarely used in modern molecular pathology laboratories. Immunohistochemistry or immunocytochemistry methods take advantage of highly specific and sensitive probes that bind and visualize target molecules within cells. These techniques are widely used in pathology as part of the diagnostic workup. While karyotyping detects large-scale structural abnormalities in the chromosome, IHC and ICC detect the expression of proteins. Tissue specimens are hybridized with an antibody against a specific protein. Any bound antibody is then detected via a probe that emits a detectable signal. The resolution of IHC and ICC is low, but is slightly better than with karyotyping. Fluorescence in situ hybridization uses fluorescently tagged sequences of DNA or RNA that are complementary to specific regions of the genetic material of cells. The fluorescent probes are designed to bind to known genetic alterations, such as translocations, inversions, deletions, and duplications, so that they can be visualized in cells using a fluorescence microscope. Like with IHC and ICC, the resolution is low. PCR-based assays amplify a DNA region of interest, initiated by the binding of short complementary DNA probes called primers. The amplified DNA is detected as an increasing signal from dyes that are incorporated into the newly produced DNA strands. They have much higher resolution than any of the techniques previously discussed. An extension of PCR that allows detection of RNA and thus assessment of gene expression is RT-PCR, or reverse transcription polymerase chain reaction. Here, the PCR is preceded by a step in which a reverse transcriptase converts RNA into complementary DNA. In some PCR-based assays, the primers are complementary to a known mutation. Thus, only that mutation triggers a signal. Other PCR-based assays target regions of DNA that are known to frequently harbor mutations, so-called hotspots, and reveal any mutations that may have occurred within the targeted region of interest. PCR-based assays are also used to detect differences in the length of a DNA region of interest caused by insertions or deletions. These differences can be evaluated by fragment analysis, whereby the amplified DNA is separated by size on an electrophoresis gel. Sanger sequencing and next-generation sequencing are types of gene sequencing. Both of these provide high-resolution sequencing, but in contrast to Sanger sequencing, NGS offers much higher throughput and the ability to sequence several genes at the same time. Gene sequencing synthesizes copies of the DNA being investigated and monitors the identity of the nucleotides that are added as the new DNA strand extends. The different types of gene sequencing differ in how the added nucleotides are detected. Sanger sequencing was the first practical DNA sequencing method, and with a number of improvements, is still used today. However, while the Sanger method sequences a single DNA fragment at a time, NGS sequences millions of fragments simultaneously per run, enabling fast and relatively cost-effective sequencing. NGS has the potential to detect the full gamut of genetic modifications relevant for molecular profiling. It also allows interrogation of one or a selected panel of genes, examining changes in all protein-coding regions of the genome, or capturing the entire sequence of a patient's genetic makeup. One important advantage of NGS is that it allows detection of unforeseen genetic aberrations because it characterizes the complete sequence or selected stretches of DNA, as opposed to PCR-based assays that probe for predefined mutations. A continuous challenge of NGS is the difficulty in interpreting potentially large amounts of output data. The use of NGS in molecular profiling in a clinical setting has gained considerable traction in recent years. Although routine implementation of NGS in clinical practice may not be possible everywhere today, the benefit of comprehensive tumor characterization justifies promoting the adoption of NGS for various indications. There are ways of reducing the cost of NGS to a hospital or healthcare system, such as running with the right testing volume, typically 400 samples per year, or using a focused panel that scrutinizes selected genes. If the cost of running NGS can be justified, it is easily the biomarker test of choice for many cancers.